he's done wonders. Magic, basically.
Dr. De Bayon is putting in a storming run.
A real professional, loves his job, loves his life, and loves getting out there and showing everyone what he can do and giving it his all every time.
Dr. De Bayon, what a win here for Louisa Carberry. Dr. De Bayon wins the French Gold Cup.
To come from a year off straight into the Grand Steep and win it is nothing short than a miracle.
He's a joy to have. He's a horse that's just full of life, and he really, really wants to win.
We've come to the heart of rural France to meet Anglo-Irish couple Louisa and Philip Carberry. From their charming farmhouse here at Senon in the west of France, they train a string of 30 horses, including dual Grade 1 winner and leading Grand Steeplechase de Paris hope, Dr. De Bayon. Louise, I've got the impression that the Grand Steeplechase de Paris for you, it's not just a race, it's something, it's an event that's had a really a profound influence on your life and your career.
Yeah, very much so. I think I was embarrassingly ignorant about a lot of French National Hunt racing, to my shame now, but one race I did know about was the Grand Steep. I remember seeing at school a picture of either Sirlite or Coquejet jumping the Rivier de Tribune at a time, thinking, wow, what a jump, amazing. So that sort of definitely piqued my interest in the different style of jumps, probably demands a little bit more intelligence, athleticism from horse and jockey. So, yeah, although I didn't know enough about French racing, I certainly, the Grand Steep, and then I met Philip the day of the Grand Steeplechase de Paris at Auteuil. The last day he rode Princesse d'Anjou, who'd won him the race twice. So it's certainly been a race that we've always been excited about and wanted to have a runner and do well in.
I never thought I would ever be associated with the race or anything like that. It has just so much character, and it's just slightly exotic. You know, every jump is different. You can never relax in that race because you never know what's going to happen. And so, totally beyond dreams to be associated with that race. Ouch.
We've been here for 7 years now. There's about 30 trainers here and about 600 horses. A mixture of flat and jumps, I'd say it's probably 70% flat, 30% jump, something like that. We've got a brilliant cross-country field, which has banks, ditches, miniature bullfinch, wall, all of that. And then we've got two tracks we can see here, one of hurdles and one of steeplechase, four either side, so we can do a nice circuit, get some going, a nice rhythm, then jump from fence to fence, a bit like in a race they would eventually.
And just across the road, there's the Senon race course.
Yes, absolutely, it's brilliant, a really nice little track. Some good horses have started there, including Sylvain Jaco-Conti, who was one of them, and Belle La Vie won a Grand Steeplechase de Paris as well. First races at Senon, really nice little track, and after the day's racing, we're allowed to also school run there, gallop run there. Yesterday it was open for gallop, so it's fantastic. We have the training facility and the race course to use as well when it's possible.
2.5, okay.
Yeah, so you do 2.5 gallop chasse. Alexia will tell you, James.
Yeah.
And then you just canter on the turn and let them on up the straight.
From an early age, I've always followed racing, and I didn't really know anyone in particular in racing. My uncle did train, but just loved it. I love thoroughbreds and really enjoyed following all of that. So during and after university, I always had a keen eye on racing and started riding out a little bit with Henrietta Knight to begin with, actually, and then my friend Tor Sturgis. And I knew racing was the route I wanted to go down, and I thought it was a good time to travel and narrowed it down to Australia, America or France. And France attracts me with fantastic history, racing, breeding, and also a much bigger National Hunt side than those other two countries. And I thought also it wasn't that far from home, so if it all went wrong, I could get home quick.
When you met Philip, were you aware of the Carberry family dynasty?
Oh yeah, an amazing family, just talent without even thinking about it. Seeing everything that Tommy did, he won a Group 1 on the flat and over jumps, the Gold Cup, Grand Nationals, just, you know, absolute legend. Paul Carberry is someone that I think even Tony McCoy and Ruby Walsh would say is one of the most natural horsemen that's ever been. Nina flying the flag for the girls, fantastic jockey in her own right, and just brilliant. Philip won the champion hurdle already. So, I mean, it's sort of embarrassing how good they are. So, yeah, I'm a mere interloper into their family.
Well, the trainer's licence is in Louisa's name.
Yes, it is.
And you work together on a daily basis. How does that go? Who's boss?
I think he'd say I was, but I think everything has to be his idea.
No, obviously Louisa's full credit to her. She's done an amazing job. It's all credit to her. I help in every way I can as well, but she's the trainer and she deserves all the credit. I'm just here to help. And it's tough starting off, but you know, we're starting to bear fruit from the work. But all credit to her. Yeah.
Going back to Dr. de Ballon in the Grand Steeplechase de Paris, he hasn't had a straightforward relationship with the race. Tell us a little bit about his ups and downs before he went on to win last year's edition.
As a five-year-old, he won, I think, three chases on a trot, and we then ran him in a grade two. And so turning into six, the beginning of his sixth year, we thought, right, we're going to go for the Grand Steep. We've got a horse that's good enough. We were very confident of that. And he unfortunately had an injury, brought him back the following year. And I really thought this is our year. I thought, I've got everything is right, the horse is flying, the jockey's flying, oh, this is it. And there was quite a few runners that year, and he is a hold-up horse, and he came into the rail ditch, and unfortunately there was a bit of a arrowhead in front of him. One horse fell and got stuck in the jump, two were a bit close to him, and he was sandwiched between them and met it wrong, and unfortunately unseated Felix.
Oh, Crystal Beach is down and Dr. de Ballon is down.
I genuinely thought that was my chance. We're young, got a small yard. This doesn't happen every year. And I said to my brother after the race, that was a career-making race, that we've just lost that opportunity. It was a huge thing. The next year, COVID happened, and more or less the date of the race, we brought the horse in from the field, having had another injury, and 5 months to the day of us bringing him in, we had him ready to run, ran him in a hurdle race at Compiègne, came to about the fifth hurdle, and made a hash of it and unseated Bertrand Lestade.
And at the rear there, Dr. de Bayonne, rider did very well, clung on for a while, but ultimately gravity won.
And I remember driving home thinking, I can't believe this. This is just all going wrong again. And Philip said, no, let's go for it. We're going to do it. The horse can do it. And he filled me with huge confidence. Got there on the day, we felt the horse was really, really well, but we'd had half a run in a year and a half, so just thinking, oh my God, is this really a good thing to do? But anyway, he's such a good horse that just followed them all the way around and started making his move at the second last, joined them at the last and sprinted clear, and it just was magic.
Dr. de Bayonne, what a win here for Louisa Carberry! Dr. de Bayonne wins the French Gold Cup!
I think first sensation is relief. Oh my God, we've done it. The horse has done it, we've done it. You know, brilliant. So proud of that horse. He just is such an absolute champion. He wants to do it, he loves his job, and it's a privilege to have him and be part of his life. It's a career-making race, but it's above all satisfaction of that we were able to let the horse do his job and show how good he was. And you know, now everyone's seen how good he is, so there's nothing more to prove, and I'm just delighted for him. The horse deserves it.
And tell us about Dr. de Ballon's Grand Steeplechase win.
I can't tell much because I didn't watch it. I was too nervous.
Philip wasn't at Auteuil when he won either of his grade ones. I know you're quite superstitious. Is that right? Can you tell me a little bit about your superstitions?
I'm quite superstitious. I do plenty of things. I wear odd socks, salute magpies, don't walk on ladders, all that sort of thing. Try and keep everything the same. And Philip had been there for the year before when he fell, and it was such a disappointment that he was going to come, and he, at the last minute, he said, I can't come. If it goes wrong, I just can't face it. So he locked himself in his bedroom, turned his telephone off, and read a book for about half an hour. And I rang him off the race and sort of say, oh, it'll be brilliant. No reply, and I thought, that's odd. And eventually, I think we sent the neighbour around to see if he was all right. And he would turn his phone on half an hour later and he read the result from bottom to top, starting with the pulled up and the fallers getting in. I think people there had fallen and he thought that was our number. Oh, fallen. Can't believe it. And then got there, couldn't believe it. There we were at the top. And huge excitement. So then obviously it was actually, I don't know if he was allowed to come for the next time, but I wouldn't have allowed it. But maybe it's better he stay at home. And this year, he did mention to me this week, maybe he would come, but I don't know. It's silly to be superstitious, and at the same time, it's sad not to enjoy the horse while we've got him, and you know, enjoy the fact he's running at a high level and doing very well. So I can see both sides.
Just a nice easy piece today, and he's enjoying it. It's a big pleasure riding him every morning. He's a super horse.
Funnily enough, I feel very much less pressure now. I feel like the pressure's lifted. Seems in good order. He's definitely still wanting to do the job. And it's really a case of us just getting fit and healthy, and he'll do his best. And the jockey will too, so it's a different feeling coming into it.
He's already done more than we'd ever ask, so hopefully we get there in one piece and then everyone has a good race.
But he's a real athlete. And I think the horse is just an absolute gift from heaven. We're very lucky to have him, very lucky.